Welcome to the Leadership Lyceum, a CEO's virtual mentor. Now, here's your host, Tom Lindquist.
Glad to have you back in the Leadership Lyceum, where we bring you direct access to top CEOs and directors of boards in an interview format that provides insight on situational issues that confront CEOs every day. It is a CEO's virtual mentor. I'm delighted to be joined today by Ralph Cavanagh, co-director of the Energy Program at the NRDC, the Natural Resources Defense Council. Thank you for joining me on the program today, Ralph.
Glad to be here.
The Natural Resources Defense Council is an NGO with really a superhero's mission of working to safeguard the earth, its people, its plants and animals, and the natural systems on which all life depends. This is a tall order, requiring courageous, charismatic, and competent policy-oriented leaders of influence to carry out the mission. Ralph joined NRDC in 1979 and has focused on removing barriers to cost-effective energy efficiency and on the role that electric and gas utilities can play in leading a clean energy transition. Ralph has taught energy law and policy at Harvard Law School, Stanford Law School, UC Berkeley Law School, and at the University of Idaho. Ralph serves on several boards, the Bipartisan Policy Center, or BPC, and listeners will recall that we discussed the BPC in Episode 8 with Susan Story, CEO of American Water, a colleague of Ralph's on that board, the Northwest Energy Coalition, Renewable Northwest, the Center for Energy Efficiency and Renewable Technologies, and Ralph chairs the advisory board of the UC Davis Energy Efficiency Center. He's a graduate of Yale University and Yale Law School, and it's an honor to have you on the program, Ralph.
Thanks for inviting me.
I thought we could start with the NRDC mission, specifically its objectives around energy.
NRDC, since I joined it, has seen in energy policy and energy systems a critical source of environmental solutions. And I emphasize solutions because when I got out of law school in the 1970s, I assumed I would spend a productive career suing all of those people. It turned out differently in large measure because it became clear that a clean energy transition vitally required willing and engaged partners from across the utility sector and indeed the broader energy sector, from all the people who the environmental community had thought of as traditional villains and now increasingly sees as part of the solution rather than part of the problem.
How has that evolved over time since coming in the 70s?
The 1970s was a singularly bleak and dark time for people working on energy policy. It was a time of gasoline lines, energy rationing, sharp cost increases, increasingly adversarial, sometimes violent public clashes over what to do. At that time, most of what utilities in particular wanted to do, which was to build giant coal and nuclear plants, were fervently opposed by environmental groups. And it was a time when both sides, I think, almost despaired of a common path forward. And if you then look at where we are now, with all of its challenges, it's an incomparably more hopeful time, it seems to me, with solutions bursting out all over. With the path of a clean energy future already charted, we're not talking about an abstraction. We're talking about a process that's been underway literally for decades. And finally, one in which the utility leadership in particular is strongly committed. It's been heartening for many I know who hear from some odd corners of the Trump administration nostalgia for the very 1970s dystopia that I just described. Heartening to see how many people are saying, no, that was where we were decades ago. We've got a better path forward now. And I think we'll get there.
That's a positive statement in light of what we're seeing, this retraction or this stepping backward.
Sure. And in the negative direction, to the extent that that's a fair characterization of it, really isn't coming from people with much history or background in energy policy or leadership in the energy sector. It's coming from people who view these issues through a purely ideological lens and often simply aren't well informed about the ways in which the system has evolved.
But how far have we come, and how do we measure it?
In terms of how far we've come, since 2005, carbon dioxide emissions from the generation sector are down 25%. Sulfur emissions from the generation sector are down much more than 80%. We've seen, of course, explosive growth in renewable energy. But the most important part of the solution, the most significant single reason why we've made as much progress as we have in recent decades, is the energy efficiency resource.
In simplest terms, energy efficiency resources are created by a lowered demand for kilowatts by a customer due to more efficient appliances, for example. A kilowatt saved by a customer on the demand side is a kilowatt that does not need to be produced by a traditional power generation source. And from an environmental perspective, the cleanest kilowatt is the one you don't need to produce.
When the Bipartisan Policy Center, which you called out in your introduction, and I was glad to hear it, asked the following question in a 2013 report. They said, if you treated energy efficiency, if you look at it as a system resource, comparable to the kilowatt hours from power generation or the barrels of oil from an oil field, and you look at over the past 40 years how much we've wrung out of energy efficiency improvements across the U.S. economy, I wasn't surprised to see energy efficiency called out as the largest resource that we've developed over the past 40 years. But what might surprise you and other listeners is it turned out to be larger than all the other resources combined in terms of its contribution over the past four decades compared to additions in the other resource categories.
This is shocking, especially when you compare the addition of other resources and the likes of those resources. Think coal-fired generation over 40 years. Think nuclear power plant additions over the last 40 years and the sheer volume of those added to the system.
And I think that in turn is a function in part of energy efficiency incentives, where utilities and government have both had a cooperative role, and sustained improvements in efficiency standards at the government level, both state and federal. The integration of efficiency standards and efficiency incentives across the U.S. economy over four decades is one of the great technology and policy success stories in American and world history.
Let's repeat and pause for emphasis. One of the great technology and policy success stories in American and world history. That is the resource provided by energy efficiency.
There probably is an effective way to go about these things to achieve technological advances that benefit society in this way.
Yeah, I think for energy efficiency, a couple of things have been important. The first is to be willing to establish as a system-wide objective, as the Northwest Power Act did now almost 40 years ago. The objective was, let's try to get all cost-effective energy efficiency. Let's try to exploit all of the energy efficiency opportunities available to us at lower cost than the energy production that they displace. Let's think of energy efficiency as a resource. And then in pursuing that resource, three integrated strategies.
Industry participants, corporations, and government play a cooperative role across the integrated strategies. The three integrated strategies are, one, incentives, two, standards, which are ever-changing, hopefully for the better, and evolving, and three, innovation and R&D. We'll be right back after this short break to take apart each of these necessary components to the success of energy efficiency. Stay tuned. We're back with Ralph Cavanagh, co-director of the Energy Program for the Natural Resources Defense Council, or NRDC. Let's delve into the components of the three integrated strategies for the success of energy efficiency in this country over the last 40 years. The first is incentives.
Incentives to steadily improve the equipment, dedicated as far upstream as possible, not just rebates to customers, but rewards directly to designers and manufacturers.
I can imagine during the time, as you go back to that time period when you first started in NRDC, what naysayers might have said about energy efficiency from appliances, that it couldn't be done, that they were resistant to it.
There is no question that early on there was widespread skepticism about whether efficiency improvements were technically possible or whether they could conceivably occur on a big enough scale to matter. And some of the early proving grounds on those issues, in the Pacific Northwest, the enactment in 1980 of legislation requiring the region to treat energy efficiency like a resource and to test on a substantial scale its capacity to replace power generation. That was an important part of what happened, and much of the credit there goes to a visionary utility system leader, BPA Administrator Peter Johnson, who was a conservative Republican from Idaho, who got the business case for energy efficiency and devised some of the successful early ventures.
And back to incentives?
The best known, I guess, in the field is the refrigeration story. So there was a huge technology debate around the time people started to worry about the ozone layer. And it was clear we had to phase out chlorofluorocarbons, which were the driving force behind the cooling fluids in refrigerators. That's where you got the cooling power. A or a substantial part of it. And the conventional wisdom at the time that the chlorofluorocarbons were going to have to come out was that the only way they could come out was by dramatically increasing the energy use of refrigerators.
Known to have been one of the most energy-guzzling household appliances of the mid-1970s.
A breakthrough moment there was a national competition funded by a number of our electric utilities, which basically said to the refrigerator industry, if somebody can mass produce a CFC-free refrigerator with significant reductions in energy use compared to the status quo, we'll write you a check for $30 million. You don't get the check for a bench scale application. You've got to mass produce the refrigerator.
Effective incentives have spurred technological solutions for centuries. I'm reminded of the parallels to the fascinating story of the solution to the longitude problem. The longitude problem acted as a barrier to navigating east-west for centuries, which is one of the reasons why the New World remains so long undiscovered. Much like these advances in refrigerator efficiency, the solution to the longitude problem came at the behest of a reward. In 1714, British Parliament passed an act that provided a reward of £20,000 for the discovery of a solution to the longitude problem. That's about $4 million in 2018 dollars. It's considered one of the most effective uses of public funds to advance science and technology, and it illustrates government's role in inspiring and incentivizing solutions to the most complex of society's problems. By the way, the lucky winner of the British contest was John Harrison, a humble, skillful, and indefatigable son of a Yorkshire carpenter. Harrison's model number 4 won him the prize in 1761. Let's go back to Ralph and the refrigeration problem.
And what came out of that was a winner in the competition and a device that nobody thought could be made. A succession of gradual improvements in design as a result of both efficiency standards and incentives led over several decades to a 70%+ reduction in average use per unit, even though the average unit is bigger and has many more features. And in addition, what you got out of that virtuous transition was an appliance that today, in the average American household, is the electricity equivalent of a 50-watt light bulb for all of the services that it provides.
That ends the incentive component of the integrated energy efficiency strategies. We'll take a break and be right back to discuss standards. Stay tuned. We're back with Ralph Cavanagh, co-director of the energy program for the NRDC. We just talked about incentives among the three integrated strategies for the success of energy efficiency in this country over the last 40 years. Let's turn to ever-advancing and evolving standards.
Integrate those incentives with regular improvements in federal and state efficiency standards. And both the first state efficiency standards and the first federal efficiency standards were signed into law by Ronald Reagan, reminding us of the bipartisan tradition on efficiency. The second President Bush signed into law in 2007 the lighting standards that helped drive the final round of innovation that brought us the now nearly ubiquitous LED lighting, which is not a 70% improvement in efficiency, but more like 85%+. We've seen sustained reductions in energy intensity across every sector of the economy. We're finally beginning to glimpse them at scale in vehicles and transportation. And I think that it is in energy efficiency. It's not where all of our hope resides, but it's probably the biggest part and the least frequently told part of the story. And I'm glad we're putting some emphasis on it now.
That ends the standards component of the integrated energy efficiency strategies. Let's move on to innovation and R&D.
The third part of the equation is innovation and R&D, where both federal and state sources, along with private funders like the Electric Power Research Institute, have had important roles. And you want to think of those three tools as integrated tools, not independent, not operating as somehow replacements or substitutes for one another, but part of a portfolio of solutions that needs them all.
And the funding for all these integrated strategies?
In terms of funding, the most important single source over the years has been the utility industry itself. That's the principal capital budget, of course, for a whole host of clean energy solutions. For energy efficiency these days, it's on the order of $7.5 billion a year for the electric and gas sectors combined. That's been important for efficiency standards. Started out at the state level, moved to the federal level, remarkably little money needed for that. The annual budgets associated with setting and administering efficiency standards are in the tens of millions of dollars, no more than that. And of course, the benefits now have been calculated in the trillions of dollars.
And what about funding for the R&D component of the integrated strategy?
Then in terms of R&D, you're right to suggest that we tend to grossly underinvest in R&D across the system. Energy efficiency is no exception. Sadly, the federal government is trimming back still further on what were already inadequate investment levels. To give you a sense of how bad it is, the annual electric bill in the United States is about $400 billion. Aggregate investment in R&D and energy efficiency and renewable energy for all sectors is probably on the order of $2 billion, so well under 1%. All R&D in the energy sector is under 1% of annual revenues for the utilities alone. And if you compare that to what the high-tech sectors invest annually, it's a preposterous disparity. We need to do better there. Utilities can also increase their own investment and have a stake in doing that through research consortiums like the Electric Power Research Institute. And in California, we have a significant energy efficiency and public interest R&D budget also administered by our Energy Commission on the order of $180 million a year, which helps a little. But to the extent you're suggesting we could be doing a lot more and need to, you're absolutely right.
That ends part one of our special Earth Day episode on climate change and clean energy. Part one covered energy efficiency as an actual energy resource. Part two will cover something so ubiquitous in our modern society that it's largely invisible. We'll be right back after this short break. We're back to kick off part two of our special Earth Day episode on climate change and clean energy with our guest, Ralph Cavanagh, co-director of the Energy Program for the Natural Resources Defense Council, or NRDC. In part two, we cover something so omnipresent in our modern society that it's largely invisible: the electric transmission system, the system that supplies our electricity in bulk across the country. We'll focus a great deal of our conversation on the Western Electricity Grid, which is also referred to as the Western Interconnection. The Western Interconnection is one of four major electric system networks in North America, serving a population of over 80 million. The interconnection spans more than 1.8 million square miles in all or part of 14 Western states, bounded roughly from Colorado to the Pacific Coast and from the Canadian provinces of British Columbia and Alberta to the northern portion of Baja California in Mexico. There are fascinating dynamics, maneuverings, and diplomacy at play in that region, which is experiencing a push to integration or regionalization. It involves strategy, politics, and technology of the highest order. It's the bulk electricity system meets Hasbro's risk game. And rather than a political map of the earth, it's a spaghetti bowl of high-voltage transmission lines, substations, and power generation stations serving population centers across long, desolate distances. Let's rejoin my conversation with Ralph Cavanagh, co-director of the Energy Program for the NRDC, discussing the linkage of Western grid integration to energy efficiency resources that we covered in part one.
Western grid integration is important in making better use of all of our resources across the full spectrum, from energy efficiency to coal, and strongly and emphatically including the variable output renewables, solar and wind, that are surging onto the system. In explaining why this is important, it's helpful to start with a story from 20 years ago. I was appointed to a task force on reliability by the Secretary of Energy. At the first briefing, we were told that one of the singular challenges for the U.S. grid was how badly fragmented it was, although it was technically true to say that there were only three big grids in the United States: Texas, the northeastern part of the country, and the West. They were fragmented into more than 150 so-called balancing authorities.
From an electricity grid system perspective, the balancing authority is the critical management element. Someone has the authority to keep the system in balance, ensuring the electrical balance between the load or population center that demands or needs the power and the supplier or generation source of that power. That authority is the balancing authority.
Each of which was responsible for maintaining an instantaneous balance between loads and resources for its little corner of the grid. Now, 20 years later, there's been extensive consolidation across the rest of North America, but the West has gone from 34 balancing authorities, which were too many in 1998, to 38 today. The problem's actually gotten worse. And as a result of that, we are spending way more than we need to on reserves. We're not taking full advantage of all the opportunities to use renewables efficiently and to displace more expensive resources to operate. And we're risking reliability upsets that are completely unnecessary, all because we can't seem to break free from the grip of historical accidents that created all this fragmentation without anyone clearly planning it or establishing a rationale for it.
Balancing authorities use power supply resources to balance the demands for electricity on their systems. With the sheer number of balancing authorities across the Western interconnection, it's an easy leap to see that access to power supply resources is fragmented by these balancing authorities. The region is thereby balkanized, and this prevents access to clean energy resources that may be in abundance in one fragmented region from being used in other fragmented areas that may have only fossil-fueled power resources available to them.
What I wonder, Ralph, is just how well your average utility customer understands the benefits or the issue with grid integration. And I thought it would be real interesting if you just describe the benefits, what's at stake here, and use this as an opportunity to talk about this with the layperson, if you will.
Thank you. You're absolutely right. The average, I am confident, yet the average American has no idea that there is such a thing as grid fragmentation. Does not really have an enormous amount of motivation for learning more about the way grids operate and are overseen. By way of motivation, I would note that the potential benefits are both economic, environmental, and reliability-based, and reliability encompasses both. And I think from the recent spate of natural disasters, everybody gets just how awful it is to be deprived of electricity for any significant period of time. By not having a fully integrated grid, we increase the risk of that unpleasantness for a whole host of people, and sometimes it's more than unpleasantness. It's obviously life-threatening. At the same time, we are sacrificing economic benefits that even in the relatively short term, say by 2030, are measured in the billions of dollars a year for California alone. And finally, for people who care about a clean energy transition, for people who want to see us decarbonize the economy, and there are a growing number of those, this is an absolutely essential tool, both in the near and longer term. And if you want to know what happens when we don't do this, there's a yellow blinking light on the dashboard of the electric system, which is what are the utterly unnecessary and frustrating annual curtailments of wind and solar in California, because at times of peak production, we can't productively use all the electricity that they produce in the state. We have to turn off what is literally zero cost clean energy, simply for want of the institutional capacity and the markets that are needed to push it out to others in the West who could use that power and take advantage of those opportunities.
I'm amazed, Ralph, well, maybe puzzled is the better word, at how you bring this home to the average consumer and how you make them feel it other than when their lights, when they have a reliability problem and their lights don't go on.
Right. So certainly you do not want to have to do this in the immediate aftermath of a catastrophe. Although it is worth noting, there have been occasional moments of political clarity when the grid crashed big time, and some good has come of it. One of the celebrated illustrations was in August of 2003. Some of your listeners will remember the Great Northeast Blackout, when some maintenance problems on one small part of the system in Ohio knocked out the northeastern United States and Canada, in some cases for a couple of days. As a result of that, we significantly toughened nationally our reliability standards, and we established a new form of agency oversight to ensure that those standards were met. I don't think the average American then understood the mechanics of the problem, but the outcry that followed the reliability upset was sufficient to motivate legislators to do something. I hope we don't have to go through that again in the West. And one of the reasons why I'm optimistic that this will happen, all that we need to open the door to an integrated Western power grid is to identify a competent institution that can, in effect, invite everybody to participate. And the obvious, motivated, competent institution for that purpose is the California Independent System Operator, which is the largest of the balancing authorities in the West, has an extended history of productive interaction with the other Western states, is ready to step into this role. All that we need to do, we don't have to have average Californians demonstrating at their assemblymen and senators' offices for sophisticated grid reform. All we need is for those representatives to authorize a transition to a fully independent board for the California ISO, because understandably, the rest of the West will not join a body, all of whose members, as is the case now, are appointed by the governor of California. The governor himself recognizes this, approves of and supports a transition to a regional grid, and will be more than happy to sign that bill if it reaches his desk. So it feels like the planets are in alignment. And it's not often that you get to deliver economic, environmental, and reliability benefits of this magnitude through legislation that doesn't cost a dime.
And Ralph, you wrote in a September 13th blog about this very issue, about AB 813 and Assemblyman Chris Holden, who would have authorized, you said this is a quote from you, would have authorized California's main grid authority, the California ISO, to transition from a governor-appointed board to a fully independent board of a regional institution, which all Western utilities and generators could join. However, Assemblyman Holden announced that AB 813 would not move forward this year because, quote, there is still more to discuss on the issue. What's still to discuss there? What have been some of the features that have held this up?
A longstanding objection to enhanced grid integration had come from organized labor. And they were concerned, and this is a legitimate issue, obviously, that somehow grid integration might result in a migration of jobs out of California and into other Western states. For an extended part of the last legislative session, negotiations overseen by the governor's office occurred with labor representatives and other interests to try to find a way to overcome that objection. And indeed, it was overcome at the end of the session, but it took so long to get there and to create that formula that there simply was not enough time to get the bill through the legislature. This time around, we will be starting in January with much of the architecture of a solution already visible. And I'm hopeful that whatever other problems we may have, the calendar shouldn't be one of them this time around.
Let's take a quick break. We'll be right back with Ralph Cavanagh. We're back with Ralph Cavanagh, co-director of the energy program at the NRDC.
Who stands to lose and who stands to gain under each system, the balkanized system and the integrated system? Are there different business interests, political interests, even NGO interests maybe that come to play here?
From my perspective, almost everyone emerges a winner from a reduction in the unnecessary fragmentation of the Western grid. I suppose that the individual balancing authorities could be seen as losers, since there will be fewer of them. But it is important there to emphasize that no one is forced into this structure. It's an all-volunteer system. And it is already clear that a number of the balancing authority operators are willing to happily accept the benefits of integration in return for having fewer enterprises trying to manage what is really a single unified machine operating at the speed of light. It does not make sense to have 38 operators or something like that. Now, there are people who will have questions always, and the questions need to be answered. I would say those fell primarily into three categories in the California legislature. There was the labor question, which we've already discussed.
Mm-hmm.
There was a concern on some quarters about whether California might lose its climate and energy leadership and be subject somehow to inappropriate pressures from other states, and other states that don't like California's energy and climate leadership felt the same about California. And in all of those cases, I think ultimately people will come to see that a grid operator is not a policymaking body, that California will retain its energy identity just as Washington and Oregon and Utah and Arizona will. And then the real issue, though, at the end, and this was in some ways underscored by recent developments in the Trump administration's Department of Energy, there was a concern that somehow moving to a regional system might expose California to the baleful influence of the federal government. People said, well, if we have a multi-state grid operator, we'll be regulated by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. Absolutely true. And however, many of the people who were raising that objection didn't realize that California is already fully regulated by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission and has been since it created its own transmission organization, because that transmission organization is involved extensively in interstate commerce. A study earlier in the year by the Yale Environmental Protection Clinic, which is on our website, Secure California Energy Future, took every legal argument dealing with alleged federal interference and found that California's exposure would be no greater under a multi-state regional system than it is today. I think there are strong and rigorous responses to every concern that's been raised, and I haven't seen a single argument identifying a plausible large group of losers in these reforms. But obviously, part of the legislative process is to make that case, persuade the critical mass of people in the legislature to go forward with it. The governor is already clearly there. That's the task ahead in the months before us.
Thank you for that. And I know you had a recent blog post on that very issue, too, with the DOE Secretary Perry's desperate search for new ways to prop up coal plants.
Yeah, a word on that is important, because this was something I think a lot of people hadn't anticipated, that a pro-market, which this administration nominally is, a pro-market administration would propose using regional transmission organizations to collect subsidies to keep uneconomic power plants operating. That doesn't sound like a market-oriented administration's proposal, but it did happen. And it led some to say, well, here's yet another reason to fear the federal government. What if this rule were adopted? Wouldn't Californians find themselves perhaps compelled to subsidize uneconomic coal plants in other states? And the short answer, and I hope it's a very short and convincing answer, is that misguided though it was and is, this proposal has no impact whatever on the western states for two reasons. It only applies to power plants that are operated independent of state regulation, state cost of service regulation, and the West doesn't have any power plants, coal plants, or nuclear plants operated exclusively that way. And second, the rule only applies to regions that have specialized markets called capacity markets, operated by regional transmission organizations. California has no such markets. It's not covered by the rule. I hope and expect that that rule is going nowhere whatever, because its lack of merit will be conspicuously obvious to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, no matter what the party affiliation of its members. But even if it's adopted verbatim, it has no effect on the West, and therefore no proper role in the debate over enhanced Western grid integration.
Ralph, just as we wind the corner on the end here, as you look to the future, and maybe it's some exciting new technologies that are emerging that further enable the mission of NRDC, what's on the horizon?
I will content myself with accelerating the progress of the clean energy transition. I think that decarbonizing the economy is the great task of our time. And in terms of my optimism about doing it, it does not require dramatic advances in artificial intelligence or anything else. It requires us to stay on a path we can already see. It will not be effortless. There will need to be significant additions of renewable energy and energy efficiency. We've got to make sure that we maintain the ability of our utilities to invest, to be the critical drivers of all of the capital. It's got to be assembled to do this. And we've got a very large network across the nation of local utility officials, state regulators, who all have to continue to push in this direction. It is not an elegantly orchestrated system. There's a certain amount of chaos in it. It's relatively decentralized. And right now, that's maybe not such a bad thing. If we had a uniquely centralized and efficient command structure, it might be taking us exactly where Secretary Perry appears to want to go. We're going happily in the opposite direction. But I think it's important, again, to underscore, it is not that we have to invent something wildly different from what we've already got or overcome challenges wildly more difficult than those we've already confronted. It really is helpful to me in maintaining a sense of purpose and possibility to think back to just how awful things were in the mid-1970s across the full spectrum of energy policy and energy services. To realize how far we've come, how much progress we've made in terms of the leadership of all the institutions that matter, and all of that is now available to be marshaled for the next stage in the process. It will be fun to watch. No one thought that 40 years ago. No one wanted to be along for the ride. I think most of us are more than prepared to be there now.
Ralph, thank you.
Thanks for a great interview.
The Leadership Lyceum, a CEO's virtual mentor, has been a production of The Leadership Lyceum, LLC. Copyright 2016, all rights reserved.
Come back and listen. It's lonely at the top.